Gonna lose weight, amen.
Amen.
We're gonna work out.
Amen.
See, you work out because you're at a point and everything from that point goes out. Does that make sense? See, we work from salvation, not for salvation. We are saved, now let's work. That's one of my favorite prayer songs. Let's work. Amen. Y'all missed the radio. I'm sorry about that. Back. 95 praises. Y'all were able to listen to good R&B. I understand. But that, we got to work out. Come out. You see what I'm saying? Some of us have started a point, but we ain't working. We ain't working. But the guy said, life, they ain't working, boss. We ain't working. We saved, but that's it. I'm happy. I'm waiting for the glory train. But if you look at the stories in the Bible, if you look at the parables, oftentimes when it talks about working, it's always something that's done from the state of you are here, now work. You're in the vineyard, now labor. You're saying, now do something. It's not because you're working for, it's because you're working out. And you have to work out your soul salvation. The Lord is not going to save lazy servants. And it doesn't matter when you begin. If you begin at the age of 20 or the age of 120, you get the same reward. Because that's the goodness of God. Brothers and sisters, let me hasten on. Verse number 19, the Bible says, watch this. And what is the exceeding greatness of his power? Now he's going to use a lot of words that mean the same thing. Paul is a wordsmith. I love Paul. I love word studies. Paul is going to use four terms with the same word. He's going to use the Greek term dunamis. He's going to use the Greek term eistos. He's going to use the Greek term exousia. He's going to use the Greek term exousia. He's going to use the Greek term dunamis. Watch what he does here. He says in verse number 19, and what is the exceeding megathos, large greatness of his power. God has power. He has energy to work with us. Watch this. To us who believe according to the working. That's the Amen God. Amen God. It's where we get the word energy. He says the working of his iskos, and then he uses another word, kratos. It is, iskos means the inherent power. In other words, it's like looking at a bodybuilder and you see his muscles. He didn't have to pick up a thing, but you know he's strong. You know why? Because you're looking at his muscles, amen? Those muscles say he's got the power. Now whether or not he uses it, that's up to him. But then the next word, kratos, means demonstrative or demonstrative power. Not only does God have the power, God uses the power. You remember that song, I Got the Power? I'm trying to help you out this morning. God has the power.
Yes.
He has the strength. And then in verse number 20, I want you to see this. Watch this. Which he wrought. That word wrought, underlined in the King James Version, wrought. That word, he goes from Ermega, or Ermegia, to Ermego. In there go, where we get the word energy from, literally means the effectual working power. We just said James chapter 5, verse 16. The effectual fervent prayer, that's the same word here. In there go. It is energy. God has effectual power to change some things. What are you going to change, Paul? He says, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand in heavenly places. The Lord did something for Jesus that he's going to do for you. In the Old Testament, God was seen as God primarily because he demonstrated what's called creative power. When the Lord said, let there be light, Gardner C. Taylor would say like this. He said, everything that was not strained to become. When there wasn't any light, the Lord said, let there be. And before you get the words out, there was light. The Lord says, I'm going to make man. And he grabbed dirt. He blew it too. The Bible says he became a living soul. He created something. That was God's power in demonstration. But in the New Testament, the Lord switched gears. And he says, let me demonstrate my power a different way. I'm going to demonstrate my power by raising my son from the dead. See, for some of y'all, that didn't really move on. Because you were like, well, I know the story. But no, you don't understand the context. For a Jew, for somebody to raise somebody from the dead indicated something. It indicated that there must be God. You remember when Jesus went to the young lady, the young man, one who was sick for just a little while, and the son of man, and then he went to his best friend by the name of Lazarus, and he said, Lazarus, he called him by name because the old preacher would say, he just said, get up, everybody would have gotten up, amen. But he had to call him by name, Lazarus, arise. And the Bible says, Lazarus came out hopping. Now, I know the Bible didn't say hopping, but he did because, number one, he was wrapped like a mummy. That was how the ancient Near Easterns, they would wrap the dead body. So he hopped out, amen. Bible says, Jesus says, unloose him and let him go. Unwrap him and let him go. I love that story because when people saw that, see, they could have made fun of this first miracle because the girl had only been dead for a few hours. The young man was only dead for a day or two, and in the Hebrew understanding of death, they believed that a soul hovered about around the body for about 3 days. And so in some instances, it could reattach to the body. But the Lord waited 4 days on this one. The Lord said, I'm going to get my glory this time. Yeah, he talked about me bad the first time, the second time, but I'm going to get my glory. The Lord says, I'm glad he's dead. Do you know the story? Do I have to preach that again? He was glad Lazarus had died. Why? Because you're going to see I'm God.
Amen.
And how God proves his power in this instance is, he says, I'm going to raise my son from the dead. Why is that important, preacher? I want you to see why it's important. Because in verse 21, he says, well, not only am I going to raise him, I'm going to set him on the right hand. The dexios. It is opposed to the left. The right hand of any man meant that was authority, that was power. The Lord gave his son power. He is now the head. He is now the ruler of all things in the universe. He says in verse 21, far above all principality, underline principality, and power, underline power, and might and dominion, that every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in the one to come. Preacher, what are you telling me? I'm telling you that you got to understand who you're dealing with. The Lord is so powerful that he says he's above every single name you can think of. But what about Buddha? He's above Buddha. Confucius, above Confucius. Hawkins, he's above Hawkins. Einstein, he's above Einstein. Anybody you can think of, Jesus Christ's name is above all things. Understand what we're dealing with contextually and culturally. In this time of the day, in Paul's day, people would believe in what they would call deities, stars. They would worship the stars, the moons. They would say anything outside of Israel, even the Jews would say anything outside of Israel was ruled by fate. It was just a chance that you took. That's why we have astrology today. What do the stars say? Anybody heard that before? Let me see what my stars say. They believed in that more so in this day than even in our day. So they believed that things were ruled by higher powers, and oftentimes they believed that demonic powers gave leaders their power. And that is partially true because the Bible says that the rulers of this world, talking about the dark rulers, the principalities, that really speaks to archangels and demonic angels. But he says Jesus Christ is above all that. That at the name of Jesus Christ, every knee will bow. That and every tongue shall confess. That's showing you, brothers and sisters, you should have hope in your calling. And as we close this lesson, brothers and sisters, understand this. He says in verse 22, he says, and have put all things under his feet. And watch this. And he gave, he did your mind. He gave, watch this. He gave him to be head over all things to the church. Now, in some translations, some of your newer translations, that word church there is not really the word church. Take another lesson to teach on that. But really, the word church is not in the original text. The word church is really a late addition to the word assembly. The word ecclesia comes from a compound word preposition, ek means out of, and the verb kaleo means to call. And so it puts those two words together. You have ecclesia, or the called out. Those who are in Christ are part of the called out. That means you and I are part of the body of Christ. And Jesus is the head of that body. And then verse 23, the Bible says, who fills all in all. In other words, he is ruling, but he is in everything and everybody. The sad reality, however, is that many of us are in the body of Christ, but we don't have any Jesus in us. We don't have any Jesus in us. We got a lot of devil in us, but we ain't got a lot of Jesus. And you, as a child of God, must allow Jesus to fill your heart. Every day you should pray, God, show me the way. Show me where I need growth. Show me where I've stumbled. Show me where I messed up. I'm praying for that. Brothers and sisters, this is the climax of chapter 1. I want you to get this, because in chapter 2, we're going to see something bigger. Paul says, this as a point of review, he says, I'm praying preemptively for the predestined people of God. He says, I'm praying for you because you have hope and glory. And watch this, and you are God's inheritance. One of the things I love about this chapter is that it says something that made me scratch my head. It says that we are God's inheritance. Now, what does that mean? Because I'm thinking I'm inheriting something. But the scripture teaches us that we are God's inheritance. That's something different. You know what that means? In short, it literally means that you and I are what God will inherit once we die. He says we are his prized possession. We are his prized possession. Someone here from me, 1 Peter chapter 2. I think that's what I want. Go to 1 Peter chapter 2. We close it on this. 1 Peter chapter 2, I think, is what I want. Look at verse number 9, 1 Peter chapter 2, verse number 9. What do you find verse 16? This is talking about Christians. But ye
are a chosen generation.
You are a chosen. That word is ekletos. You have been chosen. It's the adjective form of the word election. He's describing what you are. You are a chosen generation, a genos. That means a tribe or a people. You are chosen by God. You are a royal, and I know we know what that means, a royal priesthood. But here's the word that really got it. Keep reading. A holy nation.
A peculiar people.
Stop right there. A peculiar people. Now, when you learn better, you do better. For many years, I thought that phrase literally meant we were strange. Because as Christians, we are strange. We act right. We're supposed to be right. We're not supposed to be common. So I took that to mean that we were common, we were uncommon. But if you do research on that term, it literally means we are God's purchased possession. It literally means that God paid for you. God paid for you. And he paid it through his blood. And let me tell you, just like that car used to sell, anytime somebody paid for something, it was theirs. I had no right to go into that car and say, hey man, I'm going to take it home for a couple of days, I'm going to bring it back, then I need the keys. If the owner said, no, you're not, guess what? No, you're not. Why? Because I purchased this thing. Let me come to your house and take your TV home and see what you say. Hey, man, I got some game tomorrow, man, and I can't see no my black and white TV. Can I take this 50-inch home? No. Sorry, my brother, you got to get your own. But why is it when it comes to the Lord, we treat the Lord's purchased possession as if it was ours? Why do we do that? Why do we do that? Nah, you see, I'm my own person. See, I don't give all that religious stuff. I'm a Christian, but you know, hey, after Sunday, after 12 o'clock, I gotta go, man. Listen, man, the party's gonna be at that Kaya. Kaya's still gonna be at the compound. I got to go tonight. I don't even give the Lord one whole day. I give him an hour and a half. It better not make it an hour and 45 minutes. I give you Sunday, but it's me, Monday through Saturday. We treat God's call like it's ours. Am I wrong about it? But the Lord says, you are mine now. And I do with you what I please. Brothers and sisters, if you're not a member of the Lord's church, that's how you become a part of the purchased possession. You can't be a part of God's possession outside of Christ. All these promises that I just read to you were Christians who were added to the body of Christ. Notice I said the body of Christ, not the body of Baptists, not the body of Catholics, not the body of first day, second day, third day, 15th day, seventh day of Adventists. God has one body, just like you got one body. And if you want to be part of the one body, you got to be added to the body. Acts chapter 2, verse 38, all the way through verse 47, the Lord says, and God added to the body such as should. Really bad translation, such as was being saved. If you want to be in the body of Christ, you got to be added. But you got to come by way of Jesus Christ. Jesus says over there in Mark chapter 16, he that believeth, faith, he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. And the saved are in the one body. The one body is the head of Jesus Christ. And so you will be in the body. But if you're outside the body, you're not saved. You're damned. I'm not cursing, I'm just telling you, that's what it is. You are damned. And we don't preach on that anymore. We preach on everything else. How to get along with your boss. Five ways to wealth. All that's well and good, but let me tell you, you're going to die.
Amen.
One day you're going to die, and where will you be? Without Christ, you'll be lost. Come to Jesus Christ. Hear the word. Believe. Repent of your sins. Confess that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And be baptized for the remission of your sins. That's the call. That's the call. Because God has done everything else for you. He sent his Son down on the cross for you. All he's saying is just come to the invite. Come to the feast that's already ready. Is there anyone here this morning that wants to come down this morning? Anybody here that's ready to give their life to Jesus Christ? If you are, let's stand right now as we sing the song of invitation.